About 2 years ago, we talked a little bit about asthma when I came here. And I was reviewing and, you know, Halle said, hey, Javi, let's just think about a little bit about asthma, again, anything changed. So, you know, you go back and you start thinking and reviewing and not too much is coming up for the acute management of status asthmaticus. There were a couple of things, but very advanced therapy. So I was scratching my head. I said, but it's getting better. So what are we doing differently? So I am going to focus this talk in the things that we did there that are actually helping us to manage asthma, even though they're not based in new therapies. We think that in medicine, everything is new therapies. And actually, probably 80% of the time, it's not. It's how we use the system. Every time there's a new medication, we all want to use it, but we don't want to analyze the consequences of the cost or the taste or the side effects. As a matter of fact, I was very pleased when I heard this morning the controversies of vaccine, no vaccines, neonatal ICUs, where we are, where we're not. I was talking to my friends from all different places that if you do quality improvement, you like a lot the says that the Chinese have. And there is a very old Chinese proverb that says, you do not know where you're going until you know where are you taking your first step. So to know how you're going to move forward, you need to know where you stand. So some of the changes and objectives we're going to have today are based on we were not going anywhere. We have a bunch of asthma in Cincinnati, and we're scratching our heads and saying, but why is that? And until we start saying, duh, we're stupid, we were not doing the right way, we were not doing it with decreased variability, and we're not doing it synchronized, and everybody was trying to do what they wanted to do when everything was so simple. So hopefully I'll make it simple for you. So we're going to recognize the symptoms of asthma in regards to pre-treatment scoring, grading the severity, which is what we did with the system scoring, and use a little bit of the evidence base. As you all know, I'm not going to repeat this, but we try to always explain to our residents and our families that there is three components of asthma, right? The vasoconstrictions, the edema, and the secretions. And you have to think that way when you're attacking status asthmaticus. First one, like in pain, you'll hear me tomorrow, and like in other talks that I've given, is you're always preventive. And still, the number one prevention is vaccines and or environment control, right? If you look at the recommendations from Tamiflu and everything else, you know, between 5 and 65, asthma is one of those that you need to consider them to be serious conditions for risk. But if you immunize with influenza, you don't have to be worrying as much as long as influenza catches it, the vaccine. Smoking, the worst irritant that you can have. So you can do anything you want about asthma, but if in the family they're still smoking, you may as well say, you know what, don't waste your time, don't waste your money, don't come to me, because the irritation is gonna be there all the time. And secondary smoke is as bad as primary smoke. Now, this is a world process, so what I did to come here too is I look at the South American guidelines, the European guidelines, and even some Middle East papers that are there, and we are pretty much the same. But the variability of application is huge, which was what indirectly was happening to us. So I'm gonna concentrate in the home part and the outpatient part. I'm not gonna concentrate that much there. I'm gonna concentrate in the emergency department, the status asthmaticus, because to give the whole circle, it will be very difficult since there's a lot of therapies changed. Most of the preventive therapy will be at home. Most of the abortive therapy are in the emergency department. Most of the abortive and acute therapies with respiratory failure are in the PICU. And you never want to have an asthmatic in the PICU. It's almost neglectful this day and age. So as usual, we go back to Cincy. We go back to that calm Sunday when everybody comes to the emergency room. And like in any given Sunday, I'm going to give you the first case. 4-year-old child with 2 hours of dry cough, mild respiratory difficulty, he's relaxed, mild intercostal retraction, normal color, vital signs 30.5, respiratory rate 28, heart rate 120, saturation is 96% in room air. So what's the first thing we need to do? You remember, right? Cardiopulmonary assessment. If you said, well, you need to treat, no, the answer is you need to do a quick assessment, 15 seconds where you are. Because you want to make sure there's nothing else associated with this kid, airway, breathing, circulation, pulse, central, peripheral, capillary field. Once you have done that, this is the headache that we had. Yes. See how difficult that it is to read for you? It was exactly as difficult for us to have it in front. Okay, so we were saying, what's going on with our guidelines and parameters? We were not scoring the asthmatics right. So I may say, this is a mild asthmatic by the score, and somebody else may say, well, that's a moderate to me, or not, I think that's a severe. So we were all over the place. Okay, it's not the same thing when you look an x-ray and you say it's broken and it has an angulation of 15 degrees. So everybody knows what we're talking in here. With asthma, we were playing all over the place. So we made a decision to pick one. There's tons of them out there, but we picked one that was very simple. Why? To score. Because when we start looking at the literature, the gold standard is still the it's the lung function test. But just think in an emergency room, you're in a stress situation, a lot of studies have proven that it doesn't help us that much. And when you compare good asthma scores to lung function tests, physical exam, for some reason always beats or equals non-inferiority testing devices. Okay? So we decided to pick one asthma score. I'm not putting down the lung function test, guys. I'm just saying that in the emergency room, we prefer these ones. And we used the PRAM score. PRAM score was, well-studied, very easy. And it looks at oxygen saturation, suprasternal retractions, up here, escalating muscle, and we'll talk about air entry and wheezing, something that medical students, paramedics, nurses, doctors, residents, fellows, mamas, and papas can all do and give a score. And that's what we decided to use. And we went through a teaching. As a matter of fact, I have my ID in my backpack, and my ID, believe it or not, has a little laminated card with those scores that I can look at them and assessment. And when the patient goes to the emergency room, the nurses assess them. And it's very simple. Saturations give the points in there. Suprasternal retractions give the points in there. By the way, the retractions, if you look, this is the one that we use when we're thinking severe. This is the other ones that we think that is in the moderate, okay? So that's why we have the points. That's the scalenic. And then we got the air entry with the scores. So if we go back to our child, and I put in there the PRAM score, let's just look to see if the history gave me something. And I have mild intercostal retraction, saturation of 96% with good movement, and an expiratory wheezing. So all of us in our emergency room may say that this person has probably a mild attack because it's from 0 to 3. Once you have scored that, then you can use any guidelines that you want, okay? We use our own guidelines that are revised every 6 months. If you want, you can go Cincinnati Children's evidence-based guidelines and you pull it up and it's there. You have them, by the way, last year when we talked to PEM Cincinnati, that app that I gave you, it gets updated too. But what this says in the mild asthmatics, I'm gonna make it easier for those who are over 40 and cannot see little letters, that you always need to consider oxygen as a supplement. Remember, attention deficit, constipation, all of those work oxygen. We're gonna concentrate on albuterol MDI with spacer and teaching. And we're gonna consider the steroids. Why do we put consider and not give it all the time? We're very strict in thinking using asthma-like medications when you're below 2 years of age, because most of the time you're dealing with viral pneumonitis or viral reactivity, not necessarily with asthma. We put them in there, and I put two options, and I'll tell you in a second why, dexamethasone and prednisolone. We're gonna observe the patient, and we're gonna discharge home on beta agonists, the steroids part, if we use it, and we are considering control therapy when we talk to the pediatrician, and if they don't have a pediatrician, we'll try to send it home on that. So a lot of education. Now, the first question that the families that were doing wrong is, wait a second, you send me home with that MDI, that little inhaler, and a little mask, yet in the emergency room, you're using nebulizers. So this must be better in the emergency room, because using nebulizers, you're sending me home with the MDI, which is not helping. So when we review our literature years ago, and still the same, NEBs have humidified oxygen, dosing better, but that's if you're given with oxygen from the wall. If you get one of those little devices that has a little filter, that's the best media for fungi. That's the best media for contamination, okay? MDIs, on the other hand, are more efficient, portable, decrease administration time. You can do it while you sleep with your kid is there. And there's no transmission of viral particles or anything like that. So what we decided to do is to study what other options are, and you can see different hospital options, and ours, which is the one at the bottom, CCHMC, we wanted to make it simple, not like calculations. And we decided to say less than 10 kilos, 4 puffs, 10 to 20 kilos, 6 puff, and below 20 kilos, 8 puff. 4, 6, 8, easy to remember. Remember, most of the tricks in medicine is not necessarily can I remember the dose, it's can I use it because it's simple enough so I don't have to remember, okay? So, First case was straightforward. What do we do for kids with mild asthma? MDIs, the puffs are given in there. We consider the use of steroids, but not all the time. And we educate, educate, educate. Now, let's say that we have another case the same day in the emergency room. And this time, things change. We got moderate respiratory difficulty, supersternal intercostal retraction, but not escalene, saturation to 93%, and diminished breath sounds with wheezing. First thing that we do in that crazy emergency room, assess the patient with the cardiopulmonary assessment. And then that you say, I have time, okay, because this is a respiratory distress, I start moving a little bit faster because time is of essence in here, and we do our score. And in this case, if you do the math, he's probably a 4 to 7. Anybody can do it. As a matter of fact, our rule, believe it or not, is once they come to triage, the nurses enter a number. From there on, every time there is an intervention, we have to enter a number to objectively say, regardless who put it in there, where the patient is moving. Not anymore like, I think he looks better. Yeah, he looks better. No, everybody has to have a little score in there and a little number. So once you get to a score, you go to the moderate, and this is what the moderate says. We still use the oxygen, like in constipation and attention deficit hyperactive disorder. We use the albuterol, either NEBA or MDI. We'll give you the option, but we incline to use the MDIs because most of the moderate will do well, and they are as good as the NEBs, okay? But there are kids that are a little more anxious, a little more upset, and sometimes the NEBs is a little easier to give, but we still force as much as we can the MDIs. We definitely use the steroids in these cases. It's not considered anymore, and there's two options that we use in there. And then there's discharge as the previous ones with the same approach with a lot of education. Now, I don't know if you noticed that in this group, we put ipratropium in there. And the evidence shows that in moderate asthmatics, in the emergency room, if it's used in two doses or two inhalations prior to the admission, it can decrease the admission rate and or shorten the hospitalization time. So that's the only time that we use ipratropium. It's in the second and third while you are in the emergency room. You don't need to continue to be ipratropium. There's not a single evidence that says that you have continuous ipratropium and it's gonna make a damn difference. It's gonna make medications more expensive, okay? So I think the question was answered very clear in a lot of studies, but here it is. Only used in the emergency department, that's what the evidence says. So the issue of ipratropium is clear. Now the steroids. The steroids, we use them 99.99.99% orally. There's no reason to put an IV. Okay, bioavailability is huge. The only reason why we put IVs is because in the severe, because we're probably getting an IV for the magnesium sulfate. Since we have the IV, let me give you the steroids IV. But orally is as good at, okay? And what we noticed though, that when we were doing the steroids, always people say, so what about if I do inhaled steroids? There's plenty of evidence that says that inhaled steroids have no role in the emergency department. This is in a study of 48 return visits, 0 versus 12% of the inhaled steroids. So to make things less complicated, we eliminated any inhaled steroids out of our emergency room. So you want to use it, that's your call. We don't use it in our emergency room because there's no proven emergency management of them. It takes a while to get the inflammation control. Then the next question that we have was, well, we're giving oral prednisolone for 5 days, what was happening? So we start tracking the prescriptions from the families to see if they were using it on day 2, 3, 4, and 5. You may say, well, you know, it's 5 days, for sure they were using it. And the answer is no, they were not even picking up the prescriptions when they were prescribed. So how are we gonna change this stuff? There were a couple of studies that were very good that they look at the dexamethasone in 2012. And 1 or 2 doses of dexamethasone were equivalent to 3 to 5 days of oral prednisolone. So we decided to say, let's make it easy and simple. So what we do, if we're gonna use the steroids, we'll give you dexamethasone in the emergency room, 1 dose, and actually we'll give you a little syringe with a calculated dose orally for the next day, so you give it 24 hours after. So we are taking away even your trip to the pharmacy. Why we're doing that is because, remember, we're a nonprofit, it's a hospital institution, and our goal is that no single asthmatic goes to our emergency department. That's how we improve care. To keep going to the emergency room, we are failing, not the families. We are. So with this, we notice a huge decrease in returns, a huge increase in utilization, and family satisfaction is much better because, as you know, trying to give medications for 5 days to a kid is much more difficult than giving it for 2 days only. Okay. Now when things get complicated, we have the third child on the same Sunday. I told you, it's a busy Sunday. And this one has severe respiratory difficulty, only using a few words, suprasternal retraction, intercostal retraction, diminished room air, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So this is the dude. And you can see that he's using a scalenic up there. So in that busy emergency room, where the time counts, in about 15 seconds, we need to do our cardiopulmonary assessment to make sure that he is only in respiratory distress or imminent failure, and not also in impending shock. Remember, not all wheezing comes from the lung, and a lot of myocarditis and cardiomyopathies can be missed, thinking that it's just another call, when in reality, it's something not related to the lungs. You still treat the lungs, but believe it or not, one of the most common myths is that myocarditis, one of the most common presentations is vomiting. And we keep calling it vomiting gastroenteritis with wheezing. Oh, it's probably viral and nobody looks to the heart. Anyway, when we score this guy, not anymore we're saying, oh, he looks like crap. No, we have a score now, and this is severe in our score. The nurse, the mother, the medical student, the resident, the fellow, and the attending, we can all agree in a number. And we go back to our guidelines, and this is what our guidelines tells you. Oxygen, okay? Remember, oxygen for constipation and attention deficit hyperactive disorder. Okay, now I put in there high flow. I'm not saying you need to use it right off the bat, but high flow has been proven that increases the laminar flow. It's almost equivalent to Eliox, but it's not the same, and increases saturation so you make you feel better. I put in there terbutaline versus epinephrine IM. Let me just put one line in there. No, we don't jump into the severe to epi IM or terbutaline, okay? I just have to put it in there because if the kid is so severely tight that he's not moving absolutely any air, your nebulizations are air movement dependent. So if you are and you put a nebulizer, the nebulization is going to go to the air. So you need to give something to start up the jump. I will probably say that I've used epi in the last year, if we use a lot of asthmatics, maybe 3 times, okay? But you need to have that weapon in there. Sometimes we forget about it. Actually, I'm just going to tell you how much we simplify things, that when we calculated the time that it takes us to get the dose of epinephrine IM because of the infrequency of these cases, we decided that what we were going to do is use the same EpiPens, okay, that we use for allergic kids. That way we don't need it to calculate anything, okay? They're a little more expensive now, but we don't use it as much, because nurses were losing a lot of time calculating the dose and those trying to calculate, so we have an EpiPen junior or EpiPen adult, and we use it if it's needed. The evidence is not one versus the other. There's lack of comparison if you look at the Cochrane library. So we tend to use epinephrine because we have an injectable form that is easy to access. I'm not saying that terbutaline doesn't work. Intermittent versus continuous NEBS. A review from 2003 basically said that in severe asthmatics, continuous nebulizations is the way to go, okay? When I call continuous nebulization, I guess you call it salbutamol, we call it albuterol, okay? But it's the beta agonist that needs to go there. So that's our main hallmark of the treatment. Magnesium sulfate, before it was left as, if you have a severe asthmatic that has no respondent and you already get the steroids, and you give him continuous nebulizations for about an hour, then get the IV, get the electrolytes, get the MacFos, and then start magnesium sulfate. Now, we're moving magnesium sulfate to the front line. Because if you have a PRAM score that is that high, there's nothing wrong now to use magnesium sulfate early, so we don't lose the time, because we notice that as you wait, there is more chances that you may not break the status, and like in a status epilepticus, the earlier the better. So we are definitely using the magnesium sulfate because when studies were done, look at that, treatment group versus control group, there is a less need of mechanical ventilation if it's used very early. Okay, beta agonist versus terbutaline IV. And I have to bring this up because I know the theophylline, I know the salbutamol, and I know the terbutaline is used in a lot of countries when I did the homework, IV. I have no problem with those. From my time, not Scott's time, but from my time, and I think Dr. Russell's time, we had aminophylline IVs and we have terbutaline IV, and actually we used to use paternal IV. So the heart rate is to go sky high until the kid says, I cannot take it anymore. And then we take it in a hypoxic heart. But what I'm trying to say that if you want to use it, it's fine. But there is no evidence, okay, right now, that makes this to be better than continuous albuterol. Your lung mucosa is so high that the absorption that you get with continued nebulizations in a patient that is breathing on their own is as equal as giving it IV. So, since there is so much toxicity associated to these agents IV, we hang around with them nebulization. That doesn't mean we have not to use it IV, but it's not our mainstream. Other modalities that we consider, but when we get here, like in inborn errors of metabolism, I'm already calling my friends from the ICU to say, hey, we need to discuss this case. High flow oxygen I mentioned, that's now in the emergency room, in the regular floors, in the PQ, and in the bathrooms, because remember, we use it for constipation. Heliox is not available all the time, but we have them. BPAP is very good and much better than intubating an asthmatic patient. Mechanical ventilation, we avoid that like there's no tomorrow. As a matter of fact, we'd rather put somebody on ketamine and a relaxation sedation, let them breathe on their own to see if we can get them out before we took the tube. And we have had cases that have gone all the way to ECMO. So, you as pediatricians, what can you do to conclude? See, I make a 3-hour into a 3 packages. Concentrate on home and outpatient. Educate your families before they go to the emergency room. But if they happen to be in the emergency room, that means, you know, something fail. If you want to stop them from getting worse, what you need to do is the following, or what we recommend to do. If it's a mild crisis, oxygen should be considered. MDIs is number 1, 4, 6, 8. Consider the steroids. We prefer dexamethasone because of compliance. And discharge them home with control therapy. If it's a moderate, definitely add ipratropium, 2 doses to see if it needs to be admitted or not, but not further. MDIs is our strong recommendation, 1, 2, 3, the last 2 with ipratropium, and discharge home with control therapy. If it's severe, early IM if there's no movement of air, terbutaline or epi. Continuous nebulization of albuterol is the one that we prefer. Ipratropium, definitely use in there. IV steroids, not necessarily is going to be better, but it's since we have an IV, because we're going to start magnesium sulfate early. Observation in the PQ, and sometimes we have to use ketamine and rapid sequent intubation. Now, the most important thing of all the things that I've said is that no patient should leave your office, the inpatient unit, or your ED without an education plan. Because if not, what you're gonna have is a revolving door of patients that keep coming back. We keep blaming them, but in reality, we should blame ourselves because we may not do the education that they need to understand when they are in a crisis, when they are in a preventive mode, and when they are being exposed to pathogens that are gonna increase their reactivity. Having said that, brought you back on time. There's only 2 days in the year that nothing can be done. The one is called yesterday. You were yesterday, you were not doing it this way. And the other one is called tomorrow. You haven't done it yet. So today when you go out, if you think this has some value, go ahead, think about the way you treat your patients and at least adopt one thing. If my recommendation will work, forget about the medications and start adopting the classification. Because if you classify them, it's gonna make it so easy for you. Because after all, there's only 3 medications. Have a great day.